Good evening and welcome back to the final night of our 2020 Youth Fellowship Weekend.
We've had a great weekend sharing with you all around our theme of vision. It's been great to welcome Curtis back to lead worship with us and to have Lynne sharing with us as well.
But it's not over yet. We've loads to come this evening. Curtis is back to lead worship and Lynne is going to share some more with us. Andrew also has an exciting announcement about the 2021 Youth Weekend.
Then we'll be heading over to Zoom for a much-loved panel discussion. But before we do that, let's pray. Lord, thank you that we can still meet together, even though we're all apart at this time. I pray for all the leaders and young people that are taking part, that they would really know that you're with them. Amen.
So let's kick off this evening with our first praise song.
Thank you. you've done for me.
Been using your online prayer room on the app, and if you haven't checked it out, what are you waiting for? This weekend our main aim is being to help you connect with God, and that is something we would love to continue to do with you throughout the year.
Our mentoring program runs all year, and we would love as many of you as possible to be a part of it. Mentoring is a really simple way for you to explore your faith with an older Christian, one-to-one or with a friend. There's lots of different ways that mentoring can happen, but most of our mentoring arrangements run for around about 6 weeks following a set topic that you would like to explore.
For more information, check out the mentoring section of the app.
But now let's continue to worship together. Thank you.
Savior's love through the storm. He is Lord, Lord of all.
But I was really blessed and encouraged with what Lynne shared with us on Friday night, and I'm really looking forward to hearing from her this evening. But first, let's pray. Lord, thank you for the setup we've been able to achieve for this weekend, Lord. I know we were all sad that we had to miss it, but it was the right thing to do, Lord. I want to pray for Lynne as she comes to talk to us now. I pray that everyone listening to us, their ears and their hearts will be open to the message she has, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hi guys, I hope that you are having a wonderful weekend so far. I have been with you on Friday night and now I am back again on Sunday night, and I will see you a little bit later on our Zoom call. Now, we are going to be doing a quick devotion style talk tonight. And so before we get started, make sure you have your Bible, you have your notebook and pen if you like doodling or taking notes, if that helps you concentrate. And also, we're going to be using Insta stories again to interact a little bit. So make sure you have your phone handy because you will need it from time to time. Okay, you ready to get started? Let's go. So the theme for this weekend is vision. And on Friday night, whenever we started, we looked at the definition for vision. And we discovered that vision is how something is seen. And on Friday night, then we looked at how God sees us and how we have been made on purpose for a purpose. And in looking at all of what vision meant for us as Ballygowan youth, we explored the Old Testament. And tonight we are going to be skipping forward a few thousand years and we're going to be delving in to the New Testament. So get your Bibles ready and start looking up Matthew chapter 5, because that's our passage for this evening. So read along with me, Matthew chapter 5. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up onto a mountainside and sat down. And his disciples came to him and he began to teach them. And Jesus said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you, you will be rewarded in heaven." So tonight we are going to be focusing specifically on verse 8, which is, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see the kingdom of God." But before we look at that verse, it's really, really, really important that you guys know the context, the background for which this verse was written. So let's find out a little bit of the background. So what is the context? What is going on in this passage? Well, this passage introduces the Sermon on the Mount. And the Sermon on the Mount is Jesus' longest and most famous teaching chunk in the Bible. And the Beatitudes start the Sermon on the Mount. And the Beatitudes are really blessings that God wants to bestow on his people. And really the whole Sermon on the Mount is Jesus' vision for all of mankind in the world. And this is how he wants people to know him and how he wants people to live if they are followers of Jesus. So it's a really key passage for us to look at, especially for a weekend like this. What is God's vision for us? And we find it in Matthew chapter 5. And really the Beatitudes that we've read there are kind of like mottos or mantras to follow that will really spur us on and encourage us in our faith. It's kind of like your school motto or your school mission statement. And I know that each school has one of those. And actually, I'm going to test right now if you know your school mission statement. So get your phones, and over on Insta Stories, I have got a little quiz for you guys to do to guess which school has which motto or mission statement. So I have been reliably informed by Andrew what schools you go to, so hopefully it's not too hard and hopefully you get at least the one school that you go to right. But yes, pop on over now to Instagram and take a vote and guess what school's motto, what school's vision matches with the quotes that I've put on Insta Stories. So head on over and do that now. So I don't know how you got on, but I hope you did at least one right. I hope you got your school right. But hopefully whenever you were reading it, you saw that there was one thing in common, that each and every school motto centres around the pupils and the staff, the people that occupy the space within that school. And they all use inspiring language and encouraging language that encourages you guys to reach your full potential and to become what you have been created to be. And just like our school models, the same can be said for the passage that we read a moment ago in Matthew chapter 5. The Beatitudes have the underlying theme in common, which is, this is God's mission statement that he has for you. And the heart of it is that we fulfill our full potential that he has created us to be. Remember, you're made on purpose for a purpose. So unlike other world religions, Christianity introduces us to a God who loves us unconditionally. But also our God wants to spend time with us and offer us second chances, offer us grace and love that we will never deserve. And we know and we can stand firm that actually what I've just said is true, because there's countless examples of the Bible where people keep messing up and God gives them second chances. There's countless examples that Jesus just draws near to people as they realise that they have messed up. In fact, Jesus in Matthew 11:28 tells us actually whenever we're messing up that we are specifically to come to him. It says, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Jesus genuinely wants to spend time with us. He genuinely wants to seek. He really wants us to seek him in times of joy, in times of trials, and he genuinely wants us to be brave enough to trust him with our entire lives. And in all of the Beatitudes that we have read earlier on, this theme shines most clearly through the sixth Beatitude, which is found in verse 8. And that's the one that we're looking at. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And I don't know about you, but actually I really struggle with this beatitude because of one word, and that word is the pure in heart, this concept of purity. And whenever we are presented with this word purity or pure, often if you're like me, and I've talked to some of the teenagers in my youth group and they would agree with this, so hopefully you agree, but if you don't, come tell me, that whenever you hear purity, our minds are led straight to the things that we can't do. Do you know the stuff like what you can't do in a relationship, or what you can't do whenever you're out at a party with your friends, or what words you can't use because they are bad words? And so I, whenever I think of purity, think of all the unpure things that perhaps I'm tempted or have done in relationships, parties, or in general conversation. When we think of purity, sometimes we think of the stuff that we feel that we need to do to have a clean and sinful life, sinless life, sorry, I should say. And whenever we do that, we realise, oh my goodness, we're such bad people. And so then it's just not worth following Jesus because it just feels too hard. And you know what? If you're sitting there being like, actually, Christianity is all about what you can't do, I don't want to follow Jesus, I am with you, brother. I am with you, sister. If that's what Christianity is all about, I don't want to follow Jesus. But you know what? That's not what this verse means. And we're going to explore what it actually means now. You see, whenever I mess up, I sometimes feel guilty and inadequate. But actually, that's what Satan wants to tell us. That's not what Jesus wants to tell us. Actually, the important thing in the sixth Beatitude in Matthew chapter 5, verse 8, the important meaning behind when Jesus says pure of heart is actually there to encourage us, not discourage us. You see, when he is referring to pure of heart, he is not referring to our external actions, the stuff we do in relationships, the stuff we do at parties, or the stuff or things we say to friends. Actually, it's not necessarily about what we do or don't do. Instead, it's referring to our internal purity. Our internal purity. Now, cast your mind back to Friday night. Whenever we looked at the Old Testament, we looked at how that Samuel went to appoint the new king, and he was presented with Jesse's sons, and they were strong, they were good looking. On the external, on the outside, they looked like the right king. But actually the king that Jesus appointed, or God appointed, I should say, was David, who on the outside was small, he was weak, he was quiet, he was not a leader, but actually internally his heart was in the right place, he followed God, his priorities were right, and that is who God wanted to anoint and appoint as king. And actually we looked at how God doesn't care about the externals. He cares about what's going in our hearts and in our minds. And that's why God picked David, because his heart was positioned towards Jesus. And tonight's passage in Matthew chapter 5, verse 8, this also reminds us that Jesus, once again, is concerned with our heart's position, not what we are doing outside, not what people see, not what people assume about us. Jesus doesn't waste time in his teachings speaking to our external lives. And I know some of the stuff that we're going to like to debate, and we're going to do that tonight. And that's fine, because there is a godly way that God wants us to follow. And that's great. And we'll come to that a little bit later on, actually, in my talk, as well as the debate. But actually, first and foremost, before we get our actions right, God is concerned about our heart. He knows that that's most important, that in order to have a full life, in order to fulfill our purpose and our vision that he has for us, our hearts first need to be changed. It doesn't matter what we're doing, our hearts need to be changed first. And it's when we experience that heart shift, our behaviours, our actions, our external lives will also start to change as a result of it. Jesus wants our hearts to genuinely desire things that are pleasing to him, and then our lives will reflect and produce the things that are pleasing to him. Because when we receive Jesus into our lives and make that commitment to follow him, he begins that transformation with us in our hearts, in our internal, and then the external will follow. Our love for him will translate into a hunger to know him and thirst to live like him. And that is what this passage is talking about when it says a pure heart. A heart that desires nothing more than to try its best to pursue God, because they know that that's truly what they have been made to do. Guys, remember, you're made for a purpose and you're made on a purpose. And God's vision for your life is in a wonderful adventure that actually, if we're brave enough to step in, so many awesome things will happen. So also within this beatitude, Jesus also tells us that actually that when our hearts are positioned towards him, that actually we'll start to see some really cool things show up in our lives. Because actually God knows our heart, he knows our desires, and he knows what we're passionate in, and actually he wants to use those things for his glory. And the truth is that even after we accept Jesus into our lives, although like we will have eternal life, we will have a Saviour who loves us and cares for us and will be walking with us as we pray with him and read our Bible daily. But actually, even though we'll be like playing rugby or we will be baking or doing whatever it is that we're passionate about, actually, Jesus knows that life is tough and life is hard, and actually sometimes we're going to fail and stumble and fall. But thankfully, remember at the start, we talked about this. God is a God of second chances. God, if we have him beside us, whenever we fall, whenever we fail, he's there right there with his hand stretched out, waiting to lift us up, to pick us up from the ground, because he wants and desires the very best of us. And if our heart truly desires him and his will in our lives, even through our failures, we will be blessed whenever we see God, because our hearts are pure. Now we're coming to the end of this weekend, and I know we've got one more session after this, which I am coming onto the call. I'm excited. And you throughout this weekend have explored what vision is and what God's vision is for your life. And you guys now at the end of this weekend have a choice. Are you going to step forward and make the brave step to walk in God's vision for you? Are you going to walk with purpose, knowing that you've been made on purpose for a purpose in what Jesus' vision for you is? And if you are someone who's like, you know what, I'm going to recommit, or I'm going to commit for the first time, or actually I just need a little extra help in doing this because it's tough, and it is tough, guys, it is. If that's you, what I am encouraging you to do now is to take your phone out. And on the Insta stories, there's going to be a little submission box on Insta stories. And if it's you, I want you to be brave enough to type your name and go, look, I need some help because I want to walk in God's vision for my life. And when you submit, Andrew will read that and he will then connect you with either him or another leader to help support you in this adventure, in this journey. Guys, if you forget anything, just remember this, okay? Remember this. God's vision is that you are made on purpose. You are made for a purpose. And actually walking with God allows you to achieve so much more. And he will be able to use the things that you're passionate about in ways that you cannot imagine. It's really a hard decision, but it's a really blessed decision, and I really am excited to hear how you guys are getting on. Let me pray to close. So Lord, I thank you for these guys. I thank you for Ballygowan Youth, and I thank you, Lord, that the leaders are so impassioned by you, that these guys are looking at what your vision is. And so Lord, I just pray now, Holy Spirit, wherever these guys are at, that they will feel your presence close, that they will know that they're made for purpose and on purpose, and that, Lord, that they will start walking in the vision that you have got for them right now and today. And Lord, we pray for bravery as people step out and ask for support and help. And we just pray, Lord, that if they need help, that they know that their leaders are there to support them. Yeah. Amen.
Try me and see every worthless affection hidden in me, and all I'm asking for is that you cleanse me, Lord. Create in me the power of secret shame. Come wash away the guilty stain of all my sin. Clothe me in robes of righteousness. Cover my nakedness with grace. All of my life before you. Conquer the power of secret shame. Come wash away the guilty stain of all my sin. Clothe me in robes of righteousness. Cover my nakedness with grace. All of my life before you now, I humbly bring.
Fantastic word. And don't forget, Lynne will be joining us over on Zoom at 8 p.m. for discussion and final debate.
And we've come to the end of our 2020 weekend, so that can mean only one thing. Let's hand over to Andrew to find out some more about what's in store for next year.
Well guys, I'm sure just like us, you're really, really excited and can't wait to hear what our plans are for our 2021 youth weekend. Our 2020 weekend did not go as we had planned, but you know what? That leads us nicely into our theme for 2021. Our 2021 weekend will be from the 19th to the 21st of March, and we'll be looking at the theme of never gonna stop. Throughout the weekend, we're gonna unpack what do we do when life throws those things at us that make us want to throw in the towel and give up on everything. Our faith and the Bible tells us to persevere, to keep going, to run the race as good and faithful servants. And throughout the weekend, we're going to unpack that. We're going to unpack how we just keep praising in those times of difficulty. How if we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, then we'll be able to keep running the race. We're going to look at those things in our lives that we struggle with that tempt us away from God, and how we can just look at them and say, no, I'm never going to stop praising Jesus. Even when it feels like we're never going to stop giving into those things, we're going to look at how we look at them through the lens of our faith. We're really excited for our speaker this year, and we hope to be able to announce who that is really, really soon. We've got some fantastic seminars that were planned for our 2020 weekend that we're going to carry over into 2021. And of course, we're going to head back to Faith Mission Centre in March, and we hope that that is where we can all meet together from the 19th to the 21st. Tickets will go on sale just before Christmas for those of you that want to get those into your stockings as part of your present. But this year there's going to be no price break until February, so you can still get the best price possible in the new year. We hope you will join us up in Portadown from the 19th to the 21st of March for our 2021 Youth Weekend.
Thanks so much for joining us this year, and we can't wait for you to join us in 2021.
But don't forget, the fun isn't over yet. Go and stick on the kettle and head over to Zoom and join us at 8 p.m.
And there's still your online prayer room available in the app. We want to say a huge thank you to Curtis for leading us in worship and to Lynne for sharing with us.
Most of all, we want to thank you for joining us.
Right guys, debate time.
See you at 8 o'clock.